Lugupeetavad kolleegid, kallid sõbrad, külalised. Mul on äärmiselt hea meel Eesti gastroenteroloogide seltsi nimel seda sessiooni avada. Tere tulemast sessioonile Terve magu terveks eluks. Muud on ka gastroenteroloogias. Ma usun, et paljudki teist on lõpetanud ülikooli 70-ndatel, 80-ndatel, 90-ndatel. Ja ma usun, et te mäletate, et kroonilisest gastriidist ja gastriidist üldse räägiti palju, diagnoositi palju ja me ka ravisime seda. Eelmisel aastal oli meil üks täienduskursus, kus me rääkisime seedetrakti haigustest ja üks kuulaja küsis, kas kroonilist gastriiti üldse tänapäeval diagnoositaksegi, kas see on olemas. Et tegelikult me oleme ühe olulise haiguse ja selle haiguse seosed teiste võimalike haigustega jätnud tahaplaanile. Me küll räägime maost, aga tuletage meelde, me räägime väga palju gastroösofagaalsest refluksihaigusest. Gastroenteroloogias on moes tänapäeval ka teised haigused, nagu põletikuline soolehaigus, tsöliaak ja mitmedki kroonilised maksahaigused. Mul on äärmiselt hea meel täna tagasi olla mao juures. Me räägime täna gastriidist, helikobakterist, düspeptiliste vaevustega patsiendi käsitlusest, võimalikest uuringutest, täpsustamaks patsiendi maoseisundit, maovähist ja räägime ka sellest, et milline on üks kõhuvaevustega patsiendi optimaalne käsitlus. Kas me peaksime kõiki haigeid suunama gastroskoopiale? Me oleme palunud täna esinema väga suurepärased lektorid. Me alustame ja esimeseks ettekandjaks on meil professor Pentti Sipponen, kes on patoloogia professor ja pikka aega töötanud Helsingi Ülikooli haigla Jorvia haigla patoloogia osakonna juhatajana. Mainimata tema mitmeid auhindu ja tiitleid. Võib-olla ainukene, mida ma tahaks rõhutada, et mitmed aastad oli professor Pentti Sipponen ka Euroopa Helicobacter pylori uuringugrupi president. Teiseks väga tuntud esinejaks on professor Mikko Salasporu, kes on sisearst ja gastroenteroloog, gastroenteroloogia professor ja ta on olnud Helsingi Ülikooli arstiteaduskonna dekaan ja tema uuringutöö teemad, millest ta on maailmakuulus, on seotud alkoholhaiguste ja aldehüüdiga. Ja samamoodi mitmeid autasusi mainimata. Ja kolmandaks esinejaks on professor Kari Sürjanen, kes on patoloog, patoloogia professor ja töötanud Koobio ülikooli arstiteaduskonna dekaanina ja arstiteaduskonna professorina. Ja viimane ettekandja on meil koduettekandja, küll kirurg, aga ikkagi tuntud, doktor Toomas Sillakivi, kes räägib gastriinist, pepsinogeenist ja uuringutest sellega seoses. Mul on väga hea meel avada see sessioon ja korraldusliku külje pealt ma tahaksin teile meelde tuletada, et ajakavas meil oli küll plaanitud väike vaheaeg kahe esimese ettekande järel, aga kuna kõik need ettekanded on teemade poolest omavahel väga tihedalt seotud, siis me vaheaega ei tee ja me küsime küsimusi iga ettekande järgi. Esimeseks ettekandeks ma annangi sõna professor Pentti Sipponenile ja tema ettekanne teema on terve mao kontseptsioon, maovaevustega patsiendi uurimise kaasaegsed võimalused, väheinvasiivsed meetodid. Palun.
Dear colleagues, it's a great pleasure and a great honor to be here. I have been Estonia many, many times, and I am also so pleased to be here. We have had between Finland and Estonia co-work on chronic gastritis over the decades to Tartu University, where Professor Kallio Villako was the head of the group at that time. Kallio Villako is not anymore present here. It is really very great honor to be here. We are also very grateful to Professor Ants Petsalu and Riina Salubere to organize this meeting, because I personally see that chronic gastritis is still important disease, but it is also very important to realize whether somebody has healthy normal stomach mucosa. Because when you have healthy stomach mucosa, you are free of many diseases. You can't have peptic ulcer disease, and you can't have gastric cancer if you have normal healthy stomach mucosa. I try to emphasize this issue to you today. And you can make a diagnosis of gastritis or healthy normal stomach mucosa by endoscopy, of course. If you take biopsies and you have good biopsy pathology service, you can make a diagnosis quite easily. But the other possibility is to use biomarkers and to assay from blood serum the biomarker levels, and by those levels you can decide whether the stomach mucosa is healthy or whether it is sick. And this is the point I try to emphasize to you. Unfortunately, even though I have been in Estonia so many times, I can't Estonian language, but therefore I have to have my lecture in English. But I try to be so clear as possible that you would understand what I mean. Now, when you are a practicing doctor and you are facing a patient, you certainly always think, it's crossing your mind, whether the stomach mucosa is healthy or whether it is sick. And if it is sick, in which way it is sick. And you also may consider whether the patient have H. pylori infection. Should I eradicate H. pylori or not? You may also think whether the patient has atrophic gastritis, and you're considering whether the stomach is achlorhydric, acid-free. These are the questions you certainly are asking yourself, and you are asking them in your mind. And these are important questions, really, to the patient. And you may also possibly be thinking whether the patient would need PPI. If you give PPI, you have to know that the stomach is hypoacid. And you also may think, what is the risk of gastric cancer and what is the risk of peptic ulcer disease in the patient you are heading? These are the questions you have to have some answer before you begin any medicine. If you look what is the practice today in Finland, at least, even at present. This is some facts we have collected in Finland. Patients who are adults. And nowadays, only 23% of people have H. pylori infection and it is sick. And 77% of Finnish people have nowadays in adulthood normal and healthy stomach mucosa. Anyhow, in Finland, the endoscopy, gastroscopy, is so common. And I have wondered, is this why? Why is it so common, even though 77% of people in Finland have, in fact, healthy stomach mucosa, and they are free of any diseases, risk of any disease? 3.5%, however, have atrophic gastritis, and they have severe atrophic gastritis associated with acid-free stomach. But you see, the malpractice, what we have in Finland, is that 13% of patients who have acid-free stomach will anyhow get PPIs. And certainly, this is This is malpractice, this is a nonsense. Why do you give PPI to the patient who don't have acid in the stomach at all? Only who will benefit of this practice is drug company, not the patient, not you, and not the Estonian society. And if you also look what is a reflux disease, what is so common, it is a fact is that 26% of patients who have acid-free stomach in Finland have anyhow reflux symptoms, indicating that this reflux symptom in clinical practice is very vacuous sign of the disease. And therefore, you need something more than the symptoms the patient have, because symptoms, certainly they are guiding, but they are not facts at all. And therefore, you very easily you are getting into the malpractice if you don't do endoscopy and biopsy, or if you don't do this laboratory test to check from the blood sample whether stomach is healthy or not. And this biomarker test, which is a modern handy way to make a diagnosis of sick stomach, is what we call gastropanel in Finland. It is a Finnish test which is collected based very much upon the research what we have done in Estonia and Finland on gastritis. And therefore it is more or less it's our own test and also belongs to Estonia as well. And the gastropanel is composing of biomarkers. First one is pepsinogen 1, PG1, or ratio between PG1 and PG2. And this ratio and PG1 is indicator of the corpus mucosa, and they are also indicator of the acid output. If PG1 is low, certainly the stomach mucosa can't secrete acid. And the other marker is gastrin 17. And this gastrin 17 is specific biomarker for antral mucosa because gastrin 17 is secreted only from antral G cells. If these antral G cells from this antral area are lost, you have atrophic gastritis in antrum, then certainly gastrin 17 goes down, and it is one sign of the atrophy. Then we have a biomarker, what is H. pylori antibodies, and this antibody biomarker is highly specific. It has been tested in France, indicating that sensitivity and specificity of these antibodies are around 95%. So it's very sensitive and specific test. Gastrin 17 is also the indicator of the acidity in the stomach because gastrin 17 is responding to the acid in the stomach. This is a table showing how PG1 is associated with atrophy of the corpus mucosa. This is corpus mucosa and indicates that the corpus mucosa is normal, as indicates that you only have gastritis. Before we call this superficial gastritis, and gastritis without atrophy, A1, A2, and A3 indicates mild, moderate, and severe atrophic gastritis. As you can see, PG1 will go down very dramatically with increasing rate of atrophy in corpus mucosa, showing very clearly that PG1 is very good indicator of corpus atrophy, corpus atrophic gastritis. And as you can see, these are the same patients. Here we have measured acid output, peak acid output, and you can see the peak acid output goes in the same way, showing that the increasing atrophy in corpus means that the acid output is gone and is very low. And what happens in the stomach when we have acid coming from a corpus mucosa? It inhibits the G cells to secrete gastrin 17. And gastrin 17 is on the hand stimulating the stomach mucosa, corpus mucosa, to secrete acid. So we have this controlling circle, which is physiological in the stomach. The higher is the acidity in the stomach, the lower is the gastrin 17 in normal stomach. And if acidity is very low, if the stomach is not secreting acid, is acid-free, it means that gastrin 17 goes up if intramucosa is normal. If we look what is the normal value of the gastrin 17 in when we have normal healthy mucosa, is it between 1 and 7 picomoles per liter. If it is below or if it is higher, something is wrong in the stomach. So the gastrin 17 is also the indicator whether the stomach is functioning normally or not. What happens when we look at what is H. pylori gastritis? H. pylori gastritis is, in fact, even though it is quite low in frequency in Finland now, it is anyhow worldwidely, it is most important chronic disease, most common chronic disease, because it is associated with peptic ulcer disease, and it is also associated with gastric cancer. When we will have H. pylori gastritis, people are immediately at risk to get a peptic ulcer. When we have H. pylori gastritis, it will progress gradually to atrophic gastritis, to intestinal metaplasia, acid-free stomach, to dysplasia, and to gastric cancer. This is so-called chorea sequence. And this is, for instance, the sequence we have studied in our co-work between Tartu University and Helsinki University over the years from the beginning of the 70s. This is fact. And when we are progressing in this way, the risk of gastric cancer will gradually increase. There happens a lot of issues which contribute to the cancer risk. One is, for instance, acetaldehyde. And Mikko Salasporo is going to talk about this, what the acetaldehyde means as a risk of cancer in stomach, in esophagus, and in the oral area. So when we now look at the stomach, the antral mucosa and corpus mucosa, we can categorize the people to different risk groups. If the patient has atrophic gastritis, this is once again normal superficial gastritis, mild, moderate, severe atrophy, atrophic gastritis in corpus, and the same in antrum. We can categorize patients who have severe atrophic gastritis both in antrum and corpus. It is the most severe risk group for gastric cancer, and they have a very high risk of cancer compared if you have normal and healthy stomach mucosa. The risk can be even 90 times higher than the gastric cancer risk in patients who have healthy and normal gastric mucosa. Risk of peptic ulcer is a little bit different because when you have atrophic gastritis, acid-free stomach, you can't have peptic ulcer because it is so-called old Schwartz principle, no acid, no ulcer. If stomach is acid-free, you don't get peptic ulcer. But if you have H. pylori infection and gastritis in antral area in particular, the risk of peptic ulcer is quite high. So we based upon the status of antral corpus mucosa, we can categorize patients to different risk groups, which from clinical viewpoint, in my opinion, is important to realize. You can do it by endoscopy and biopsy, but you also can do it by using these biomarkers. And Professor Kari Syrjänen will talk about these biomarkers later on. So anyhow, we can categorize the patient by endoscopy and histology, and by biomarkers to three major categories, in my opinion. First one is the patient has healthy, normal stomach mucosa. In biomarkers, it means that all biomarker levels are normal. You don't have H. pylori antibodies, PG1 is normal, PG1-PG ratio is normal, gastrin 17 is normal. Then you have normal and healthy stomach mucosa. If you only have H. pylori antibodies, but nothing else, otherwise the gastropanel is normal, then you have chronic gastritis, absolutely, but there are no atrophy in antrum or no atrophy in corpus. Acid secretion is basically normal. And atrophic gastritis is if you have PG1 is low and if PG1, PG2 ratio is low. If in these cases, if castin-17 is high, it means that you have atrophic gastritis that is limited only to the corpus area. If castin-17 is low or it is normal, it is not increased, it means that you have atrophic gastritis also in antral area, then you have atrophic gastritis which is both in antrum and corpus, and those are the patients who have the highest gastric cancer risk, and they should be identified from the population for so early treatment as possible. So what is this really means in clinical perspectives? The group 1 healthy stomach mucosa means that the risk of gastric cancer or peptic ulcer is minimal, practically zero. I, for instance, personally, I have healthy stomach mucosa, and I know that I will never get gastric cancer. And I will also, even though I am traveling, for instance, in Africa, I know that I am not going to have bleeding peptic ulcer, and I have to have a blood transfusion or whatsoever if I don't eat NSAIDs and aspirin. Ordinary peptic ulcer disease is not possible in healthy stomach mucosa, and this is also the one fact which was realized by Nobel Prize in 2005 when Barry Marshall and Robin Warren got Nobel Prize about H. pylori discovery, and it was associated to peptic ulcer diseases at that time. If you have H. pylori gastritis, then immediately you have peptic ulcer risk. But gastric cancer risk is at individual level quite low anyhow. And then you have to consider whether I should make eradication of H. pylori to the patient or not. If you have atrophic gastritis, it means that you have low acid output. Gastric stomach is acid-free in the most advanced cases. It is ridiculous to give to that patient PPI because the acid is already low in those patients. But you have the risk of gastric cancer in those patients. The gastric cancer risk is remarkable, and endoscopy is needed to this patient because the risk is so high that endoscopy, when you find this type of patient, you have to order and refer the patient to endoscopy. But in addition, you also have other risks, because in corpus atrophy, the stomach mucosa don't secrete intrinsic factor, and B12 vitamin is not absorbed properly. That means that in longer run, these patients have always they have B12 vitamin deficiency, and in addition, B12 vitamin deficiency also some micronutrients are not absorbed properly. Calcium is not absorbed properly. Iron is not absorbed properly, and so on. Therefore, atrophic gastritis is a risk condition you should diagnose in your practice and to make supplementation of this vitamins and micronutrients if needed. But the most important is that the risk of gastric cancer is high in those patients, and they should always be tried to endoscopize so quickly as possible. To find gastric cancer at so early state as possible, or to find the precancer lesions like dysplasia or intraepithelial neoplasia. So what you should do, because you are considering certainly the best to the patient. So if you feel fine, a healthy stomach mucosa, instant gastroscopy is not mandatory because gastroscopy will not give anything new to you because you know already now that stomach is healthy and stomach. Why to do gastroscopy? It would be better to do colonoscopy to the patient. If patient has stomach abdominal complaints, it is better order to make first colonoscopy, because probably you will find the reason for the complaints from colon more likely than from the stomach. On the other hand, if you had a patient with H. pylori gastritis, you have to consider, should I make H. pylori eradication or not? And that has to be negotiated with the patient. Is he or she willing to do that? And how old is the patient, and so on. And if you will find atrophic gastritis independently, whether it is H. pylori positive or negative, the endoscopy should be carried out. And it is, in fact, is mandatory. And if those patients have H. pylori infection same time, eradication H. pylori is recommended internationally in consensus recommendations. So you can find this data from literature, and it is international group of people. We have written couple of years ago a review on these issues, and you can find it from Scandinavian Journal of Gastroenterology, and it is a free access paper, and more details and more data you can find that paper if you like. So what is this three dimensional classification in practice? Healthy stomach mucosa nowadays in Finland is very, very common, as I said in the beginning. In some other countries, in developing populations, it is on the other hand more infrequent, more rare. And I would estimate that now in Estonia, 50% of people have H. pylori infection, and 50% probably would have normal healthy stomach mucosa. I remember the time in early 70s when we began to co-work with Estonia Tartu University, and I argued with Heidi Maros, that Heidi said to me that, Pentti, this gastritis is a normal condition. I said, no, Heidi, it is not, but it is so common in Estonia, and it's going to disappear in the future. And now it is going down also in Estonia, and in Finland we are a little bit ahead, so that in Finland now 70% have a normal mucosa, and only some 25-30% have gastritis or atrophic gastritis. So gastritis is in developing world disappearing disease. It will happen the same what happened to tuberculosis in the past. Tuberculosis was past very, very common everywhere. Now it's quite rare. So how helpful this screening, these biomarkers would be in finding the patients at risk for gastric cancer? This is one example. We did a couple of years ago in Finland a big study where we screened with PG1, pepsinogen 1, over 22,000 men who were a little bit elderly, and we found that over 2,000 of these men, some 10% had low PG1 level. And we offered endoscopy to everybody who had this low PG1, and we could do the endoscopy to 1,344 patients. And what we found 11 cases of gastric cancer, which are invasive cancers. And of those cancers, 7 were early. And when later on we went look at the patient, we could save all these 7 early cancers. They are even still alive. There were 4 cancers which were advanced, and those advanced cancers died in a couple of years. And in addition, we also found practically 50 patients with pre-cancer lesions. And we could estimate that we could prevent several gastric cancer, because when we diagnosed these pre-cancer lesions, they could be endoscopically removed, and therefore the patient never got invasive gastric cancer. So the screening is certainly possible. And now it is unpublished yet, but we did an analysis of PG1 screening in other study in Finland, and we followed the patient 15 years who were screened, and we could show that the gastric cancer mortality in those patients who were followed up 15 years decreased by approximately 25%. So that's this type of preventive approach is helpful, and we can really find and and help these people who otherwise are lost. Gastric cancer is so devastating a disease that when you will get gastric cancer, it immediately means that you will die in 80% frequency. And all the procedures, surgical procedures we are giving to them is more or less theater or some cosmetics. They don't help this patient. We should always try to diagnose gastric cancer so early as possible. So this biomarker test, gastro panel, what we use in Finland, is highly sensitive and specific. This is a quite big study from Sweden, which was a population-based investigation study. And the accuracy of gastro panel to diagnose H. pylori gastritis, atrophic gas, normal stomach mucosa, was 85%. And the errors which were in this between this test was all based upon the endoscopy and improper histology and interpretation of histological findings and the gastro panel, so that the accuracy is at 85% at least. So in other materials, if you look the sensitivity and specificity, they are very high. If we had a question whether stomach is healthy or whether stomach is ill, so the sensitivity and specificity of biomarkers is practically 100%. And also, if we have the question whether patient have H. pylori, gastritis, non-atrophic or atrophic, the sensitivity and specificity is again high. So this is my second last slide, indicating that what is a gastro panel, how it can be used in our clinical practice when you are facing a patient. You don't need to be gastroenterologist. You can use gastro panel even though you are GPs and family doctors. It is a non-invasive method. It is easy to use. You send the patient to laboratory because it's laboratory test from blood and serum. It saves money because it is cheap. It can rationalize your diagnostics, because when you are thinking who would need endoscopy, which kind of endoscopy, in which order, when, and then you can make, okay, you can check the stomach with this biomarker test first, and then you make a decision. And also it enables the screening of patients who are at risk for gastric cancer or at risk for peptic ulcer. And what is important, it very specifically can separate the patient who have healthy stomach mucosa, who don't need so much attention regarding risk of gastric cancer or peptic ulcer, because the risk in those healthy people of gastric cancer or peptic ulcer are very low. So it's because the motto is terve maku terveks eluks. I think so it is quite good because when as doctors it is not necessary that we always find the disease in the patient. We can also find the patient. Okay, you have a healthy stomach mucosa. You are not at risk for gastric cancer, peptic ulcer disease, and those patients probably are very happy about that. It is also the duty as a doctor to give to some patients a good and positive response. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Nyt on meil võimalus küsida. Mikrofonid on olemas. Vahet ei ole, mis keeles tahate küsida, selles keeles võite küsida. Tundub, et kuulajaskond mõtleb. Aha, ma näen ühte küsimust. Ja palun.
Tere. Ma küsin pigem eesti keeles. Et kas on mingi gradeering, et kui see marker on kõrge ja see viitab näiteks maopõletikule, kui see on veel kõrgem, see tähendab, et mingi displaasia on olemas. Ja kui on ülikõrge, siis vähirisk on kõige kõrgem. Nagu prostataspetsiifilise antigeeniga on meil, nagu, kui see on väga kõrge, tõenäoliselt on vähk.
Do you know any correlation between the values of gastropanel answers and the chronic gastritis? If you have value higher, then the chronic gastritis is more deeper, or gastric cancer is possible?
If I understood correctly, so with the gastropanel values, you can also evaluate it, the level of the risk. If PG1 is very, very low, it means that your atrophic gastritis is very, very severe. And the more severe is the atrophic gastritis, the higher is the risk, and vice versa. And therefore, it is not the dichotomy only, it is also the level of the markers. But anyhow, if you have atrophic gastritis, it would not be severe. Would it be moderate, for instance? I think so. It is worthwhile also to endoscopize.
Nii, klar, korrelatsioon on olemas. Kas on küsimusi veel? I'd like to ask about PPIs. Do you think that we overuse PPIs?
Yeah, absolutely, because PPI is used absolutely too often without any reasons. I know PPI because I also worked with Astra in that time when they developed it. I know it is fantastic drug. But it is very effective, but is absolutely overused and misused. And now it is coming more and more information that this overuse is also causing some harms. For instance, if you use PPI for a long time, you are ending to the same category as with atrophic gastritis. Stomach remains to be acid-free. And if stomach is acid-free, it is not normal. For instance, if you give the patient to carbonate tablets and the stomach is acid-free, they are not absorbed. The reason is that calcium carbonate is not absorbing. But if you have acid in the stomach, calcium carbonate is changed, metabolized in the stomach to calcium chloride. And calcium chloride is very absorbable. And therefore, for instance, if the patient are on the PPI long time and you give calcium carbonate, you don't treat the patient at all. Calcium is not absorbed and osteoporosis is not improved. This is one example of the harms what you have when you overuse the PPIs. And therefore, the exact diagnosis is important. Know the reason why do you give PPI to the patient. Has the patient hyperacidity at all? Or is the stomach hypoacid, acid-free? And as I saw in my slides in the beginning, in Finland at least, there are a lot of people who eat PPI even though they have acid-free stomach, which is some kind of malpractice from us. We are too easily prescribing PPI. That's my strong opinion, but I am not saying that PPI would not be important. It is important drug, but it's too free the reasons it is used to.
Thank you. I'd like to ask about Finland also. Do you think that you perform in Finland too many gastroscopies, or the number of gastroscopies in Finland are optimal? Just for audience, in Estonia we perform every year 45,000 gastroscopies.
Yeah, you see, as a pathologist, I got some of my salary as serving the gastroenterologist who did endoscopies. For instance, Mikko Salaspuro is one of my friend. We did a lot of endoscopies when we were younger. And we certainly thought that they are important. But now when we look at the figures and the frequencies of healthy stomach mucosa in Finland, I am little bit now changed my opinion, said, yes, in Finland we do too many endoscopies, too easily. If somebody has symptoms, abdominal complaints, immediately the endoscopy. Anyhow, endoscopy is invasive procedure. It is quite expensive. It is expensive in Estonia as well. And therefore, if we have some easier and more simple pre-test, I would agree, and I would say this is good. And therefore, I am emphasizing that we could use gastropanel more often to see that whether we have healthy stomach mucosa or sick stomach mucosa. If it is sick, then gastroscopy, in my opinion, is okay. If you wish, you can do it. But if it is healthy, then I would say, yes, don't do gastroscopy now. Do colonoscopy now and consider later on whether gastroscopy is necessary. I would, so by saying that, in my opinion, we do in Finland at least too many gastroscopies with faint symptoms.
Thank you. Kas meil on saalist küsimusi? Ma ei saa mitte küsimata jätta helikobakteri kohta. Do you think 7 days triple therapy, is it optimal for helicobacter or any news in the future for helicobacter?
You see, I am a pathologist. I don't treat the patient. Therefore, I am not the correct person to answer that. It is Hans, Mikko, or Thomas who can give the answer more. But you see, I don't know. But you see, anyhow, the problem with H. pylori eradication is that so many people will get resistant strains, and I don't know how the problem should be solved. I personally believe that one possibility is this quadruple therapy, where we also add the bismuth to the drugs. But whether 7 days is enough, whether you have to have 10 days, I don't know. You know better than me. Don't ask me.
Okay, I just wondering about Finland. Okay, thank you very much.